Good afternoon. It's the appointed time. We have formed the quorum. I'll call the meeting to order. We will use the request to speak button or request to speak system. Please do not change your seat after you're seated. Let's invite the government officials to join us. I'd like to welcome government officials to join us. The administration has already made a consolidated response to the submissions from the KPMG Tax Services Limited, as well as the Hong Kong Federation of Insurers. The paper number is CB1605-2023-01. I'll invite Ms. Chen to walk us through the paper first. Thank you, Chair. This consolidated response is to reply to the inquiries made by the Hong Kong Federation of Insurers in their further submission, as well as by KPMG Tax Services Limited. We made a brief oral response in the last meeting. In response to Clause 4 of the further submission, it's an inquiry about designated insurers. The HKFI asked whether the criteria has anything to do with the designated insurance holding companies and what the relevant criteria are for designated insurers. Well, there is only one criterion, that is whether the major businesses are carried on in or from Hong Kong. Well, there is only one unique criterion, and we do not intend to make further guidelines on this. The second part is in relation to Clause 10 of the further submission. It's about timeline for prescription of capital requirements. As mentioned last time, upon the passage of the bill, we will, later in 2023, consult the industry and prescribe rules in relation to the capital requirement by way of subsidiary legislation. In relation to Clause 18 and 19 of their further submission, is about shareholder controllers. That is the fit and proper criteria for shareholder controllers, as well as the approval procedure. We will follow the fit and proper criteria established, that is mentioned in Section 14A of the IO. I will look at the qualification, experience, as well as competency, etc. As for the process of application for approval, it's the same as the current practice. The HKFI asked whether we need to consult legal advisors. We believe that there is no need for us to do so. The next inquiry is about prescribed qualification of actuaries. According to the requirements set out in the legislation, if it is a long-term business, then the qualification of actuaries should follow that of long-term appointed actuaries. Otherwise, the qualification should follow that for other classes of general business. The next inquiry is about clauses 33 and 37 regarding requirements on reporting and public disclosures. The insurance authority consulted the industry last year, but the consultation is still ongoing. Later on, there will be detailed requirements prescribed in form of subsidiary legislation. The next inquiry is about Clause 52. If the insurance authority requires insurers to provide reports prepared by third-party persons, what are the relevant requirements? It depends on why the insurance authority asked the insurers to submit reports prepared by third-party persons. In the process, the IA will maintain close communication with the insurers. The next inquiry is about clauses 55, 61, and 63 of the bill in relation to failure to fulfill capital requirements, and whether there will be standards or guidelines on restructuring or financial schemes. On minimum capital amount, we will prescribe rules by way of subsidiary legislation. That's what we are going to do in the next stage. As for restructuring plan and financial schemes to be submitted, we'll have to see whether the insurance failed to meet the prescribed capital amount or the minimum capital amount. If it is in relation to minimum capital amount, timely measures will have to be taken. So relevant plans will have to be formulated depending on the situation. And the funds will only cover long-term business but not general business. There are a couple of questions in relation to the taxation arrangement. We have already mentioned about this in the previous meetings, and our response this time is consistent with that we have given previously. Let's see if the IRD has anything to supplement. Thank you. In relation to taxation arrangement, the inquiries made are similar to that made by the relevant stakeholders. In relation to Clause 102 of Submission A and the third issue in Submission B, it's an inquiry about Clauses G and H of insurance business. That is, whether the assessable profits should be assessed over a period of 5 years. As mentioned last time, Clauses G and H under the Inland Revenue Ordinance, we do not treat them as insurance business. We regard them as general business as we calculate the tax to be paid. The basis used is the accounting profit. So when they calculate the profits, they should use the accounting principle to calculate the assessable profits. Our view is that even with the implementation of the RBC, there won't be an impact on the accounting profit or loss. That's why we do not intend to extend the spread over arrangement to Clauses G and H. The second inquiry is about Clauses 103 and 104 of Submission A and the fourth issue in Submission B. It is about apportioning of profits in relation to life business and non-life long-term business. Insurers usually have their own funds, and they usually keep their own records to determine the assessable profits for each business. Whether there is flexibility to use actual results over apportionment basis, well, our response is that sub-funds established by insurers or records kept by insurers on their profits, they aren't statutory requirements. The latest requirement in relation to RBC regime is that there is only one fund needed to be set up. So we'll follow a standard apportionment approach. if insurers use different apportionment approach, there won't be a standardized method to assess the profits, and there may be inconsistencies arising from that. Also, when the Inland Revenue Department assess whether the methodology is acceptable, we'll have to consider it on a case-by-case basis, and there will be a lack of certainty. So it's best to set out clearly in the legislation that a standardized methodology or apportionment approach should be followed. The next inquiry is about assessment of assessable profits of non-life long-term insurance business. The industry asked whether it is possible to use the established adjusted surplus approach to assess the assessable profits. Our understanding is that after the implementation of the RBC regime, the formula prescribed under the existing IRO will no longer be applicable. Components such as risk capital will no longer be applicable to life business. So we'll have to come up with a new methodology to calculate the assessable profits. When we come up with a new way of calculation, we have made reference to the approach adopted by insurers on calculating assessable profits from non-life long-term insurance business. So this is an amendment that has to be introduced because the methodology used under the existing regime will no longer be applicable. The next inquiry is about whether the spread over arrangement can be extended to 10 years. Under the existing IRO, there is no precedence that allows income accrued in a year of assessment to be assessed over several years of assessment. However, we understand that with the implementation of the RBC regime, there will be a one-off increase in tax, and we don't want to add pressure on the liquidity or cash flow pressure to insurers. We have made reference to other jurisdictions, such as Singapore, when they implemented the RBC regime, and they also adopted a spread over arrangement, and we think that a period of 5 years is appropriate, and a balance can be achieved as we try to alleviate the cash flow pressure on taxpayers. The next inquiry is about taxation practices towards insurance business. Our response is that the practice or the provisions applicable will remain unchanged. Apart from the amendments made under the bill, the other provisions will remain unchanged. The last inquiry is whether an unaudited quarterly returns or actuarial reports will be acceptable when filing tax. We don't require insurers to provide audited quarterly returns or reports. Any questions in relation to this paper from members? If not, we will carry on with the clause-by-clause scrutiny. We will begin from clause 64, that is page 152 of the Chinese version of the markup copy. I'll ask Mr. Andrew An to walk us through the bill. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. I will now tell you about clauses 64 to 69. They are related to Part VI of the Insurance Ordinance regarding Lloyd's. Let's first talk about what's Lloyd's. As you may know, it is an association set up in London. So there have members who are insurers. for specific industries, so members of the public may not be as aware of them. Well, considering their operation model, Lloyd's itself is not an insurer. So with regard to the provisions applicable to insurers, we have to amend Part 7 so that it would be applicable to Lloyd's as well. So on page 152, clause 64, it amends section 58 so that 10 and 13AA relating to the RBC regime, and it is made applicable to Lloyd's as well. Now 153, clause 65 adds section 50BA so that the appointment of actuary requirement is also applicable to Lloyd's. Next, 154, clause 66. Well, because section 17 and 20 of insurance ordinance have to be amended, we thus amend section 50C so that Lloyd's has to submit information to the insurance authority. We also specify that there can be exemptions to the fees submitted by Lloyd's, and this is in line with requirements imposed on other insurers. Now, 157, clause 67, adds section 50CA, so that section 21A, that is public disclosure requirement, is also applicable to Lloyd's. Next, 157 page, clause 68. That is part IVA amendment is now applicable to section 50D as well, so that Lloyd's has to maintain assets in Hong Kong. 158, clause 69. Section 17 is replaced by section 20 with regard to the reporting submission of statements, and thus section 50F is amended. 159, clause 70, it is a similar change because section 10 has to be amended. Section 51 is also amended. And we also made minor amendments to the English version. Next, 161, with regard to clause 71. Because the appointment of actuary, public disclosure, and so on, requirements have to be amended. That's why we're amending section 53A as well. So apart from disclosing the existing information, they also need to provide additional information required by the insurance authority. Next, 172, clause 72. It is in relation to section 53E's amendment that is prescribed person has to send report directly to the authority in certain cases. Such persons include existing actuaries or auditors. Next, page 174, clause 73. It is in relation to the amendment of section 64F in the Chinese version to describe the shareholder controller. Well, but this amendment does not actually change the actual definition of shareholder controllers. Now, clause 74 is about amending the interpretation of part XIA, 11A, and thus amending section 95A. Now we have two types of shareholder controllers, that is majority 50% or above, and minority that is 15% or more, but less than 50%. That would be these two types of shareholder controllers. So in 2021, we have introduced a group-wide supervisory regime, and under this regime, for MNCs, insurance groups, the authority would still have direct regulatory powers over them. And they would have control over the entire group. Now, 176, clause 75, in relation to the change with regard to clause 74, that is the amendment of section 95A, that's the requirement about shareholder controller. Now, clause 75, it's about the amendment with 95I, because there is a change from a single shareholder controller to a majority or minority shareholder controller. So before they are 50% or more voting power, before they obtain such power, they need to obtain approval from the authority. It is so that it would align with the requirements applicable to insurers. Clause 76, technical amendment made to section 95J. Again, after they have become a shareholder controller, they need to inform the authority of this. 180, clause 77, an amendment made to section 95K to tie in with the change with majority and minority shareholder controller. If a person becomes an unapproved shareholder controller without notice, they must obtain approval from the insurance authority. Next, 182, clause 78, amends section 95L. Again, because there is a change with the shareholder controller structure, we now have requirements so that they can transition into the existing shareholder controllers can transition into this arrangement. So this is to facilitate insurers' work. Next, clause 79 amends section 95M. It is in relation to procedure to become for applicants to become shareholder controller. So these are just amendments in the wording. Next, clause 80, section 95N, again, technical amendment. So that a shareholder controller of a designated insurance holding company, when it is they are no longer a fit and proper person, the insurance authority can follow up on that. Next, 187, clause 81, amend section 95O. Again, it is to tie in with the change in relation to shareholder controller, so that when they become a majority or minority shareholder controller, they have to inform the insurance authority of that. 188, clause 82, adds section 95OA to the insurance ordinance. If a majority shareholder controller becomes a minority shareholder controller, they have to inform the authority of this. Next, 190, clause 83, amends section 95P in relation to restrictions on shares if shareholder controller is unapproved or objected to. That is, again, a technical amendment to tie in with the change with the wording of shareholder controller. 193, clause 84, amend section 95Q in relation to the sale of shares in shareholder controller unapproved. That is again to tie in with the change with the wording of the shareholder, change in wording of the shareholder controller. Next, clause 85, amend section 95Y in relation to determination of fit and proper. full body corporate or corporate governance, these are factors that the authority has to consider. It is in relation to Section 14A that is the same requirement applicable to insurers. Next, because there is the addition of 95OA and Part 3 that is to be added, we have amended Section 95 set in Clause 86. 199, Clause 87 amends Section 95 set B to tie in with the changes made. If in relation to 95M, they are approved to be a shareholder controller, if they become shareholder controllers for other companies, they do not have to make another application for the person to be a shareholder controller. Now, 202, Clause 88, amends Section 95 Set C, again, a technical amendment to tie in with the changes in relation to shareholder controller. Next, I'll introduce a batch of amendments in relation to Clause 88 to 91 in relation, 89 to 91, 95 set P, 95 set set, and 95 set set E, because there are minor amendments. I wouldn't go into the details. Next, 211, Clause 92, amend Section 122, because there is a change in the word definition of insurers. We have amended the section. Next, Clause 93, amend Section 129, allows for the authority to make rules by way of subsidiary legislation. And in relation to the appointment of actuaries and exemptions, and these requirements can be made by way of subsidiarization by the insurance authority. 215, Clause 94, because there is a change with Section 129, thus Section 130 is amended so that the authority can relax certain rules. Next, 216, because Schedule 2 and 6 have been deleted, we have amended Section 138 in Clause 95 as a result. 217, Clause 96 in Part XI fee, Section 140 is added in relation to the savings and transitional arrangements in Schedule 12. We'll go into details of it in Schedule 12 when we discuss it later. Next, Clause 97, amendments made to Schedule 1. 218, it substitutes the sections applicable. That is, we have added, say, 25A. Next, Clause 98, Schedules 2 to 6 are repealed. And in accordance with Section 137, they are to be replaced by the forms in that section. Now, 2, 4, 5, 6 are in relation to forms to become key personnel of personnel, and another is on the format of forms to be submitted by insurers. Next, 219 page. Clause 99, amend Schedule 8, It's just a minor amendment with the wording.
Page 226,
clause 100. It amends Schedule 9 to the IO. It adds, according to Section 10A of the IO, the insurance authority can, in accordance with Section 13BA, object to someone to become a shareholder controller. And the approval system, that is the new under the new system, approval will have to be obtained from the insurance authority, and we are making relevant amendments in Schedule 9. Page 231, Clause 101. It adds Schedule 12 to the IO. With the implementation of the new RBC regime, we have some transitional arrangements. We'll make explanation now. Part 1 of the Schedule 12, it's applicable to shareholder controller of Hong Kong insurer. We're adding some definitions here. Page 232, there will be two types of shareholder controllers. Part 1, Section 2 of Schedule 12, pre-existing shareholder controller can transit smoothly without obtaining approval from the insurance authority. Page 233, Section 3 of the Schedule 12, under the existing mechanism, if the shareholder controller application has been approved without formally becoming a shareholder controller yet, they can transit to the new regime smoothly without obtaining further approval from the insurance authority. Page 234, Section 4 of Schedule 12, it's about pre-existing notice. Under former Section 13B, the approval procedure of shareholder controller will remain effective under the new regime during the transitional arrangement. Page 236, Section 5, Part 1 of Schedule 12, it's about pre-existing objection to shareholder controller of Hong Kong insurer. With implementation of the new regime, such objection will not be affected. If pre-existing objection is effective, then under the new regime, the objection will continue to be effective. Page 237, Section 6 of Part 1 of Schedule 12, before the implementation of the regime, the pre-existing restrictions will remain effective. Page 238, Part 2 of Schedule 12 will be applicable to actuaries of authorized insurers. We're adding some relevant definitions to this part. Page 239, Part 2, Section 8 of Schedule 12. It's about pre-existing actuary of authorized insurer carrying on long-term business. That is, no further applications will have to be made to insurance authority by these actuaries. Page 240, Section 11. Even if an actuary has not formally become an actuary of an insurer, they can transit smoothly to the new regime without making new application to the insurance authority. Section 10 of Schedule 12, Part 2, outstanding application for approval of appointment of actuary of authorized insurer. The new regime will not affect these outstanding applications. That is, these applications will continue to be effective. Section 12 of Part 2 of Schedule 12 about pre-existing revocation of approval of appointment of actuary of authorized insurer. Even with the implementation of the new regime, the revocation will continue to be effective. Page 242, Section 12 of Part 2 of Schedule 12. Pre-existing revocation approval of appointment of actuary of authorized insurer. After the implementation of the new regime, the revocation made will continue to be effective. Again, on page 242, section 13 of part 2 of schedule 12, it's about pre-existing objection to appointment of actuary of authorized insurer. With the implementation of the new regime, the objection will remain effective, and that's equivalent to revoking the appointment of actuary before the implementation of the regime. Page 243, part 3 is applicable to designated shareholder controllers, and we are adding some new definitions here. Page 244, schedule 12, part 3, section 15 is about approval for shareholder controller of designated insurance holding company. That is, no further applications will have to be made to insurance authority. Section 16, if the applications have been approved for shareholder controllers, even though they have not become officially a shareholder controller, they will not have to make further application to the insurance authority. Section 17, page 246 of the markup copy. Before the implementation of the regime, if there are outstanding applications for approval of shareholder controllers of designated insurance holding company, the applications will not be affected with the implementation of the new regime. Section 18 is about pre-existing objection to shareholder controller of designated insurance holding company. With the implementation of the new regime, the objection will not be affected, and the objection will remain effective after the implementation of the new regime. Part 4 of Schedule 12. Part 4 is about review of pre-existing decisions. Section 19 adds in interpretations in relation to this. Section 20, it's about application for review not made before commencement date. The applications made will not be affected with the implementation of the new regime. Section 21, it's about review not yet determined before commencement date. These reviews will not be affected with the implementation of the new regime. Section 22, is about determination of review on or after commencement date. The determination made by a tribunal before the implementation of the regime will remain the same as that after the implementation of the regime. That's the end of Schedule 12. We now come to Part 3, that is Clauses 102 to 108 in relation to amendments to taxation arrangement. Clause 102 amends the IRO. It adds in Section 22D. There are some definitions that are newly added. For instance, life insurance funds, non-life long-term insurance business. All these definitions will be added. Page 258, Section 23 of the IRO. The original Section 23 sets out the assessment for the long, lifelong insurance business. The first method uses 5% of the premiums, and this will not be affected by the new regime. The second methodology is the adjusted surplus approach. To put it simply, the relevant insurance business funds together with some adjustments will become the adjusted surplus. Clause 103 amends Section 23 of the IRO. The amendments are made in accordance with the original IRO, and after the adjustment, will be ascertained in accordance with subsections 44A and 4B. Section 4 is applicable to separate funds to be maintained for life insurance business. For subsection 4A, it's applicable to funds to be maintained for life insurance business and non-life long-term insurance business. Under such circumstances, the premiums or the apportionment approach will have to be taken for life insurance business and non-life long-term business. The next part is about the calculation method for adjusted surplus. It is more or less the same with the existing ordinance. Subsection 5 is similar to the original subsection 6. It's about profits made from Hong Kong and non-Hong Kong life insurance businesses. And premiums of the relevant insurance businesses will have to be taken into consideration when calculating the assessable profits. Page 266. Clause 104 amends or adds in section 23AA to 23AAE. Section 23AA is a provision to be drafted for the assessable profits. When we calculate non-life long-term assessable profits, the calculation methodology will be the same as that for adjusted surplus approach, and we briefly touched on it during the opening remark. As for the one-off increase or one-off adjustment, let me briefly explain that. Given the new RBC regime, the asset and liabilities assessment or valuation methods of the asset and liabilities of insurers will be different, so the profits tax receipts or the date of the receipts will be different. So we allow for a spread over arrangement, that is allowing the tax to be paid over a period of 5 years. For life insurance and non-life long-term insurance business, we're adding in new definitions. For 23AAC, it's about adjustment to assessable profits. Due to change in insurance capital requirements, they can choose to opt for the spread over arrangement. Once they've made a decision, they cannot withdraw such decision. And sections 23AAAD and 23AAAE see further elaborations of that. The one-off adjustment, that is on the date of the commencement of the regime and the day before the commencement date, the asset will already have been determined. If for life insurance business or non-life long-term insurance business are to be maintained, this one-off adjustment will, based on the life insurance business and non-life long-term insurance business, will be apportioned based on the assessable profits of the year of assessment. And the profits will be assessed over a period of 5 years. Page 288. Clause 105 amends section 23A of the IRO. After amendment, the calculation methodology for non-life long-term insurance business will be applicable to for calculating the profits in relation to all other businesses. As mentioned in the opening remarks, before the amendment, the risk capital will be used, or the discrepancy of the risk capital will be used for calculating the assessable profits. With the RBC regime, the discrepancy of the risk capital will be replaced by the new type of risk capital as we calculate the assessable profits.
Next, 283, clause 106, amend section 23AA. So that the requirements in the relevant 23AA sections are incorporated. Next, 284, clause 107. It relates to the ascertainment of assessable profits in relation to general insurance business or specified general insurance business of specified insurers. Next, 288, clause 108, adds 23AD and 23AE sections. They relate to the adjustment of assessment profits due to change in insurance capital requirements in relation to the spreading over arrangement. Again, if they have opt for this arrangement, they cannot back out of it. 23AE is a transitional provision. Again, upon the implementation of the RBC regime, the provisions will be applicable. Otherwise, the existing provisions will be applicable to ensure a smooth transition. Next, part four, last part of the bill. It's clauses 109 to 111 relating to amendments to other enactments. 293, clause 109 amends section 4 of the amendment to rehabilitation of offenders ordinance. It reflects the changes made to section 52. Next, 294, clause 110, an amendment made to the company's ordinance because there are changes made to determination method of assets and liabilities. We have repealed the section in relation to insurance company with long-term business to be regarded as realized profit or loss, so that the requirements are in line with companies in other sectors. The last clause, 295, clause 111. We have repealed certain definitions, or we have substituted the definitions with the amended definitions. That's it for my presentation. Let's ask the legal advisor if he has anything to add. I have nothing to add. Well, let's see if members have anything to ask. If not, I believe we have completed the clause-by-clause examination. Well, will the administration move any amendments? Do members have any amendments to move? No? All right. I want to talk about the legislative timetable. When is the administration going to resume the second reading debate? Well, depending on the chairman, is early July an appropriate time? I think 5th is better because the 12th is right before the recess, so we can do it earlier. We'll definitely work with that. Okay, so on the 5th of July, we'll go back to the council meeting for resumption of second reading debate. Well, because there aren't any amendments to be moved, we'll report to deliberations to the House Committee on 16th of June. Anything else? If not, well, thank you, members, and thank you, representatives from the administration. Well, it is because you have dealt with the objection, so we have a very smooth process. Well, we have communicated closely with each other before. That's it for the meeting. Thank you.